Hi everyone, and welcome to the webinar, New Age Skills for New Age Data Scientists. We have Mary Morlikahan with us along with Sarita Digumurthy. Let me just briefly introduce them, and both of them bring in a lot of experience and expertise in the field. So I'll not take a lot of time, but let me quickly introduce the panel. So Mary is currently Associate Dean at Professional Programs at University of Chicago Graham School, whereas Sarita is CEO and co-founder of Jigsaw Academy. Sarita has an MBA in finance followed by MA in quantitative economics from Tufts University, and she has more than 15 years of experience in she has done hands-on data science herself across various fields, including healthcare and financial services, both in India and in US. And as I said, Mary brings a lot of experience from academic side. She has worked with Northwestern University before Chicago Graham School, and she had done her MA and PhD from University of Chicago. So without much delay, let me pass on the panel to Sarita. Sarita, over to you. And as I said, so there are a few questions which we'll take in the end. So people can ask their questions through Q&A platform, and we are live on Facebook as well. So you can join us on Facebook too. Over to you, Sarita.
Thank you, Kunal. Hello, everyone. I hope everyone can hear me. Let me just share my screen so we can pull up the presentation that I'd like to go through today. So I'm just waiting for the screen to show up for everyone. I can see a few questions. So I will be responding to questions as we go through the webinar. And then, of course, there is a Q&A session right at the end where I will be taking more questions as well. So, Srikant, I can see your questions about are we going to into the end phase of data science engineer's life cycle? I can tell you the answer is no. But let me just quickly set the stage for what we'd like to do in today's webinar. Mary works, as Kunal introduced her, she works at the University of Chicago Graham School. She's an associate dean. And I work for Jigsaw Academy. So what we wanted to do today was really talk a little bit about the new age skills that everyone's talking about for data science, and sort of really make sure we all understand what we mean when we say data science, you know, and analytics. What exactly is it? What does it involve? What sort of tools and techniques and skill sets do people need for analytics? And then sort of really focus a little bit more on some of these new age techniques that you know that everyone seems to be talking about. So that's broadly how I thought I'd structure the presentation. And again, like Kunal said, if there are questions relevant to the slide I'm on, please do type them in, and I'd be happy to answer. If there are questions specific to, let's say, you know, career related questions or very specific questions, then I'd be happy to answer them right at the end. I hope that everyone's okay with that. So let me start off, by talking a little bit about what is analytics. And in fact, maybe I can ask some of the panelists here. You know, I'm sure everyone's heard about analytics, data science, machine learning, big data, and you know, there are lots of different terms. But anyone wants to tell me what they think is analytics? So when you hear the word analytics, what comes to mind? Any thoughts on that? It's about statistics. So Deepak says it is analysis, and Raj says it's about statistics. Anything else? Prediction, deriving insights from data, logical description, excellent statistics. Okay, so a lot of you, okay, making an inference from data. So, you know, these are all good answers. You know, analytics is to drive insights from data, stats computing to come up with insight. So one of the things that I think is not very clear to a lot of people is what is analytics and how is it different from data analysis, right? So generating information from data or generating insights from data is data analysis, right? And why, you know, why is there a separate term called analytics? You know, can anyone tell me, is there a difference between data analysis and analytics, or do they mean the same thing? And if they don't, then what do you think is the big difference through between analytics and data analysis? Answering a question through data. Doesn't analytics come under data science? Okay, that's another good question. So what is analytics? What is data science? What is data analysis? What is data mining? Is there a difference? Are these all talking about the same thing? Analytics is a broad term. Yes. Doing analysis using some statistical calculation algorithms. So you think it is the same thing? Data analysis, analytics, data science. So one, you know, so when we talk about data analysis, remember what you're trying to do is you are sort of trying to look at historical data on what has happened to sort of understand what happened, sort of describe what happened. So when we typically talk about analysis, right, data analysis, we are talking about historical data analysis. And our aim is to try and understand what happened, how did it happen, et cetera, right? So for example, if I wanted to understand what were my top sales categories, let's say I run an e-commerce site, right? And I want to understand which were my top selling categories, right? What sort of pricing worked for my products, et cetera. Then you're really looking at historical data analysis and you're sort of trying to understand what happened, where did it happen, how did it happen, sort of why did it happen. So these are all things that we do as part of data analysis. And I've used an e-commerce example, but you know, there are similar examples in finance or in retail or in telecom or insurance, right? Where you're sort of understanding what happened, why did it happen, how did it happen, where did it happen, and so on. So typically that is what is data analysis, you know, looking at historical data for patterns and insights and understanding of what happened. But very often companies want to be able to go one step forward, right? They sort of want to, they say, okay, look, I understand what happened, but can I sort of use that information to make an educated guess about what may happen in the future, right? So I understand, you know, this is what my sales were in the last 3 quarters. Can I use that information to come up with a guess or, you know, a sort of a prediction about what might happen in the next quarter, right? And traditionally, that has been the distinction between, say, data analysis and analytics, you know. So analytics in the traditional sense talked about using, you know, statistical algorithms or, you know, mathematical algorithms to sort of come up with a prediction about the future. Right, so that is prediction, Deepak, you're right. But, you know, so when we talk about analytics and when people talk about analytics and data science skills, and I will talk a little bit about data science and whether that is different from analytics, but I just wanted to make sure everyone understood the distinction that, you know, there is data analysis. Most of us have some skills in data analysis already. You know, it's also called reporting or business intelligence, you know, essentially where you're looking at past data to sort of understand what happened. Nowadays, it's also called descriptive analytics. But data analysis is historical data analysis to understand what happened. And when you start using the word analytics, then you are really extending that to saying, given what has happened, can I come up with a prediction about the future, right? Yes, and I will talk about machine learning as well. Now, the fact that you are trying to make a, you know, make some sort of a prediction should tell you that you are now sort of moving into a lot more complex territory, right? Because making predictions about the future is not easy, right? So it's one thing to say, I'm going to look at all the data and sort of figure out what happened. But it is another thing to say, I'm going to stick my neck out and I'm going to say, this is possibly what is going to happen in the future, right? And so there is a huge degree of difference in the complexity of the analysis that you will run or the algorithms that you will use between, let's say, doing something like historical data analysis or descriptive analytics and doing something like predictive analytics, right? So I just want to make sure everyone's sort of on board with the understanding of when we say analytics, what exactly are we talking about, right? So now most of us have an understanding of analytics and, you know, the fact that it is very, very popular, that lots of companies use analytics. So, you know, whether you're talking about companies like Facebook or Uber or Big Basket in India or Netflix or Ola, all of these companies essentially use analytics on a regular basis in order to sort of, you know, grow business, in order to make better decisions and so on. And one of the examples that I like to use, you know, which shows the power of analytics is really Netflix, right? How many of you here have Netflix accounts in India? Anyone subscribing to Netflix? Okay. So for people that don't have Netflix accounts, right? Just so you know, Netflix is, what is Netflix? What do they do? What do they do, Netflix, people that have accounts? So video streaming, right? So you can essentially watch movies and you can watch TV series and, you know, all of that, you know, online, right? So they're essentially a streaming service. But Netflix, when it first started, was essentially a DVD rental service, right? So many years ago, when they first started, essentially in the US, you could sort of say you wanted to watch this particular movie, and then, you know, you sort of order it, and then they would ship the DVD to you, and then you would watch it, and then once you finish watching it in a week or 2 weeks, you would ship it back. So it was sort of like, you know, in India, we have video rental, your shop around the corner where you can go borrow DVDs. It was sort of like that, right? But it has evolved quite dramatically into something very different now. So while it is a streaming service, it is also suddenly now a content creator, right? So, you know, Netflix now makes a lot of content. They make, a lot of TV series. They make a lot of own content, which if you think about it, is a huge change from what the original business that they were in, right? Exactly. So it's a perfect example of how analytics helped them transform this, because at the end of the day, what gave them the confidence to be able to say, I'm going to start creating content, right? How did Netflix go from somebody who was essentially renting DVDs, right? They were a video rental or a movie rental service, into having the confidence to be able to create content. And all of us know that, you know, creating TV series or creating movies, those are expensive. It's an expensive proposition, right? It's not for the faint-hearted, right? So how did Netflix have the confidence to be able to say, I'm going to create content and I'm going to be able to, you know, they had the confidence to think that they were going to be able to make money off of it. Any ideas? How did Netflix have the confidence? Because they know what the audience love, right? Because they have the data, right? So they have so much data on audience preferences, right? They have so much data on what kind of movies do, what kind of people like to watch, what kind of movies, what kind of actors, what kind of storylines, what kind of directors, right? And so because they had all of this data, they were able to sort of really mine the data to sort of understand and say, if I make a, for example, a TV series with these sort of actors, with these sort of storylines, then I'm very confident that this set of people are probably going to watch it, right? So anyone here seen House of Cards, which is a phenomenally successful Netflix series, right? So they came up, you know, a lot of how they came up with the idea for House of Cards was based on analytics, right? They said, you know, David Fincher movies, you know, Kevin Spacey, you know, this kind of storyline. They were very confident that they knew which audience would like it, right? And so that's why I like the example of Netflix so much, because it's not just about, you know, analytics being something that helps businesses make smarter decisions, etc. Sometimes, you know, businesses transform themselves. It has the ability to transform, you know, businesses. It has the ability to grow businesses. It has the ability to add a lot of strategic value to businesses, right? Lokesh is saying, I have a question. Is it good to suggest movies based on a single movie a particular person has watched? It is not a good idea to make suggestions based on a single movie, but you have to start somewhere, right? And so typically what happens is that as you watch more and more movies, you know, let's say that, you know, there've been some suggestions. You watch a few, you like some, you don't like some. The algorithm that is working in the background is learning from every action that you are taking. And it will get better and better at making suggestions the more time you spend on the site or on the system, right? So one of the reasons why everybody, YouTube recommendations too, absolutely. But one of the reasons why everybody is talking about analytics and, you know, I'm sure a lot of you have seen so many newspaper articles and so many discussions about analytics and the wave of data and all of that, is because there is a very fundamental need for, these sort of skills. How many of you people think there is a lot of hype around data science and analytics and machine learning? How many of you think, you know, maybe there is an element of hype, maybe, yeah? Yeah, so let's think about why there is so much discussion about analytics and what is the reason for why everybody seems to be talking about analytics, right? So if you if you think about fundamentally how, you know, we are evolving in the world nowadays, right? We are moving towards we are moving towards environments and systems where we are increasingly wanting a lot of personalized products, right? Think about it, right? So, you know, earlier on, you know, companies would make, for example, let's say they create promotional advertising videos, right? You know, their target segments would be very broad, right? But nowadays, when you think about yourself, right, let's say that you're browsing online and, you know, when you're browsing on Google, whatever, you see some ads, right? Ideally, you want to see ads that are very, very specific to what you are interested in, right? Is that right? Or if you're looking at a service plan from, let's say, a particular phone company, right, you would like a service plan that is more tuned to how you use, you know, your usage patterns. Right? So think about it, like most of the companies that offer products or services, right, they have a lot of pressure to sort of make them more and more personalized towards their customers because of the data that, you know, we are able to produce, because of the data that we are able to capture and store and analyze, you know, increasingly the expectation is that we are going to have more and more, you know, very, very customized, personalized outcomes for most of us, right? Even if you think about something like healthcare, right? The whole idea with healthcare is that eventually we'll be able to map, you know, we will be able to come up with healthcare recommendations based on your, your genetic makeup, right? And if you think about it, right, we are in a world where we are capturing more and more and more data. And because we are able to store the data at, very, very cheaply, a lot more, companies are able to do a lot more analysis with the data. They're able to mine and leverage the data a lot more. And over time, we are moving towards, a world where data is becoming more and more important. And the fact is that data is, you know, important in any kind of industry or any kind of domain. So, in fact, if I could ask you, can you think of any industry or any sector or any functional area that does not generate data or where you think data is not important? Can you think of any? Anything, any company, any industry, any functional area, right? Construction? You don't think that there is data generated in construction? There is, right? Even just thinking about, you know, how much time is it going to take you to build a certain kind of building, right? You can sort of make smarter decisions about, you know, how much sort of inventory or stock you need to have of the products that you need in order to make sure that there are no delays. There is data. It is data. Planning a project, you know, again, you know, if you are starting a project on a very, very new sort of endeavor with no past history, then there is no data. But very often, let's say IT companies, right? There are a lot of analytics that happen in IT project management, right? Where you look at all similar projects of a similar nature and you sort of understand what worked in the past, where have the delays been, et cetera, and you sort of use that information to say, can I identify potential bottlenecks, you know, earlier on in the process so that I don't really have to sort of really wait for that to get resolved, right? So, yeah, so exactly. Do law firms need analytics? Great question. Yes. Because, there are multiple solutions, right? So is analytics ready at this stage to be able to, at a stage where we say we don't need lawyers and, you know, an algorithm can do it? No. But there are a lot of text mining algorithms that law firms use that basically, you know, they have to go through lots and lots of documents, right? So there are solutions that are analytics focused for law firms to help them sort of really make sense of all the text documents that they're going through and sort of come up with insights around whether something is a useful document or not useful document. There are products that, legal firms use that is analytics oriented, right? Do finance companies deal with data? Absolutely. So someone like, you know, for example, let's take a bank, right? So how does a bank, let's say that, you know, you are going to the bank and you'd like to buy a new car or you'd like to buy a house, you know, you'd like to buy an apartment and you go to the bank and you'd like a loan. How do you think the bank decides whether to give you the loan or not? And how does the bank decide how much, you know, they want to sort of give you, what is the amount of the loan, right? It is CIBIL rating, but it's also, you know, they have scorecard sort of algorithms that they run. They look at your, you know, income level, they look at your demographic characteristics, how many dependents you have, you know, what your past credit history has been, and then they will come up with a, you know, recommendation on, okay, we would like to give you a loan, or we would, you know, I'm sorry, but you know, you're not credit worthy enough, right? So financial services companies, and I've just used a banking example, but financial services companies extensively used analytics, right? Extensively used analytics, right? So the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, while there is a lot of talk about analytics, and you know, everyone seems to be talking about data science and machine learning, fundamentally it is driven by a very, very strong sort of trend, which is that we are increasingly moving towards data, you know, like a data sort of oriented environment, right? We are capturing a lot more data, we are storing a lot more data. Think about it, right? And earlier, when people used to talk about data, it was, okay, I walked to a store and I bought a, let's say I bought a book, and so that was the transaction, right? But now, for example, I log into my Facebook page and I like something, is that data? Right? I upload a photo of my vacation, that is data, right? Let's say I have something like a Fitbit, right? And so it is tracking, you know, how many steps I'm taking, how well I'm sleeping, is that data? That's also data, right? I go to some, you know, yeah, exactly. So think about it, right? We are capturing more and more data. So at the end of the day, you know, even if you think that there is some element of hype, right, there is a very, very fundamental reason why there is so much interest in data skills, right? Because we are dealing with more and more data. We are generating more and more data, and companies increasingly need people who can make sense of the data, right? And that is why you see all of these articles that talk about, you know, data scientists as the new big thing. They earn more than, you know, chartered accountants, and starting salaries of data scientists are so high. And, you know, LinkedIn does this study every year where they publish based on data, right? Based on the job postings on LinkedIn, what are the top skills that people are looking for? And, you know, for 3 years in a row, analytics and data science was number one or number two in 30 different countries in the world, right? So it is really a very, very, you know, it's here to stay. You know, data skills are going to become very, very important. And because we are, you know, the complexity of the data that we are capturing and storing is only increasing, these skills are going to become more and more valuable, right? So if you look at job trends for, you know, some of these skills, you can see that there has been an increase in requirements for people with statistical knowledge or data science knowledge or R or SAS, Python, all going up, right? And that reflects in sort of the salaries that data science and analytics professionals can command, not just in India, but worldwide, right? Now, I want to spend a little bit of time on this slide because there were lots of questions on, you know, data science, predictive modeling, you know, how is that different from analytics, etc. So, So the way I think about data science, right, or data mining, I think of data mining as the umbrella term, right? So when you are essentially looking at data and trying to mine it for information, that is data mining. Within data mining, there is historical data analysis and descriptive analytics and reporting and business intelligence, which is essentially trying to answer the question of what happened, right? Then when you start going into the realm of predictive analytics, right, that's where analytics comes in. And traditionally, analytics has been used to talk about predictive analytics. So nowadays, people tend to use analytics much more broadly. But predictive analytics has been traditionally the application of statistical algorithms to data in order to make predictions about the future, right? Now, there are different types of algorithms within analytics. So something like a regression model would come into predictive analytics, but there are also some other non-statistical based algorithms that are also becoming much more and more popular, which is machine learning. So when people talk about machine learning, right, machine learning is a subset of algorithms within analytics that are not statistical in nature, that are more focused on accuracy rather than explainability. So there is not a lot of statistical knowledge that you need to implement machine learning algorithms, though they are still mathematical algorithms, and more the focus is on accuracy rather than explainability, right? Is there a difference between data analytics and big data analytics? Yes, there is, and I will come to that. Inferential and prescriptive analytics, no. So inferential is essentially a term that is used for statistics, right? Inferential statistics. But when you're talking about analytics, there's descriptive analytics, there is predictive analytics, and there is prescriptive analytics. And prescriptive analytics is when, let's say you run a model and you make some sort of a prediction about the future. Prescriptive analytics is trying to understand, okay, now that I know what I think will happen, how do I use this in a, you know, how do I use it to create, for example, a business strategy? What should I do now that I think this is what is going to happen? That's prescriptive analytics. Some machine learning algorithms are statistical based, regression family, yes. So it's not that they're not statistical based, but the traditional approach to predictive modeling has been to focus on, you know, a lot of statistics. You need some sort of a, you need to make sure that, you know, some assumptions are met around the distribution of the data and that you sort of use a statistical approach. You talk about p-values, you talk about understanding, you know, sort of figuring out the hypothesis and all of that. Machine learning models are a little bit more black box models in the sense that you don't necessarily worry about explainability and p-values and all of that and the data distribution. You sort of really focus on accuracy, right? And so you don't necessarily have to worry about explaining the model. As long as the accuracy is good, you sort of go with the machine learning models, right? And you know, there are different uses for each. Sometimes it makes sense to use more statistical based approaches. Sometimes it makes sense to use more machine learning based approaches. But machine learning models are increasingly becoming popular because a lot of solutions now have to be, you know, done real time, and accuracy is very, very important. So it may not matter to you as much why the model is working as much as making sure that the model does work, right? So that's sort of what machine learning is. So machine learning is one set of algorithms within the umbrella term of analytics, right? But you know, they're used in sort of different situations. Machine learning algorithms especially work very well with semi-structured or unstructured data. You know, if you have image data, for example, you're trying to do some pattern recognition, etc. Machine learning algorithms come in quite strongly there, right? Then big data. What is big data? Can anyone tell me what is big data? And how big is big data? Giving insights from predictive is prescriptive. Bhuvnesh, it's not just giving insights, but yeah, you know, creating solutions from the output of predictive models is prescriptive analytics. It's all kind of data in terms of terabytes or petabytes. So big data, so you're right, you know, the term itself is reasonably self-explanatory, right? Big data, because there is lots and lots and lots of data. There is no one cutoff for when something is big data, but certainly, the sizes that of data that now companies are struggling with, you know, think of somebody like a Google or a Yahoo or Amazon, for example. Think about the number of transactions and the data that they must be handling on a daily basis or on an hourly basis, right? It's a lot of data. But big data is not just about lots of data, right? And someone has mentioned here the three V's, right? So there is volume, but there is also velocity and variety. Yeah, well, there are four V's, there are six V's, yes, there are, but you know, the primary three things are volume, variety, and velocity. Variety, can anyone tell me what variety is in the context of big data? What is variety of data? It's essentially, yeah, the different types of data, right? And again, this is where structured, semi-structured data comes in, right? Most of us, when you think of data, we think of transactional databases, rows and columns of data, right? But, you know, increasingly, like I said, you know, what we capture now, data is very, very different, right? We capture Facebook likes, we capture Twitter posts, we capture, for example, I type in an address on my phone and I use Google Maps to get there, that is data, right? Or I upload a photo somewhere and that's data. I write a review somewhere and that is data. So you have data of different types now, you know, semi-structured data, unstructured data. So the reason that becomes important is that traditional database systems are not equipped to deal with anything that is not structured, that cannot be put into row and column format, right? So there is that complication. And then there is velocity, which is the rate at which this data is being generated, right? So essentially what happens is that because you're dealing with very, very large volumes of data that is of very, very different types, that is not traditional, you know, database systems are not built to equip all of this. And in order to process this data, right, instead of writing a query and then waiting for it to get processed on a massively large database, and then you end up waiting for a long time for a response, essentially, you know, there have been these parallel processing systems that have been built to sort of work with these volumes of data, right? So the data is spread out across multiple systems and your query is run across multiple systems parallelly. So it's not sequential processing, it's parallel processing. So when people talk about big data, they're really talking about big data processing across, you know, like the sort of parallel processing that is going to happen over hundreds of servers at the same time, right? Now, when you want to perform, you know, obviously the reason for having all of this data is eventually to make sense or to leverage the data, right? And that's where analytics comes in. So when you're trying to perform analytics on big data systems, you know, there are specialized tools and techniques that you will use, you know, more machine learning algorithms, more specialized tools that you will use in order to perform analytics on big data systems. So that's what big data is. You know, when people talk about big data analytics, that's what big data is. So I've broadly spoken about, you know, data mining, predictive modeling, analytics, big data analytics, machine learning, data science. We didn't talk about data science. Data science is now increasingly interchangeably being used with analytics, but data science, at least when it started, meant a more rigorous form of analytics where there was a strong emphasis on statistical learning, there's a strong emphasis on programming, and there's a strong emphasis on business understanding, right? Can we consider velocity as streaming data? Yeah, streaming data analytics, you know, yes, you can consider that. Are machine learning algorithms used mostly in case of unsupervised learning? Yes. Right. So I spoke about predictive modeling, right, which is essentially predictive analytics. When you create models that can predict what will happen in the future. Right. So those are some terms within analytics and data mining. And I thought that is important to set the context for understanding what sort of skills do you need to really become a data scientist or an analytics person. Like if you're considering a career in analytics or if you're considering picking up analytics skills, then sort of really what sort of things do you need to work on, right? And I will break that into two sort of skill sets, right? There are inherent skill sets and there are learnable skills, right? But inherently, if you're interested in analytics or if you're thinking about analytics, right? A couple of things you have to make sure that you're comfortable with. One is quantitative skills, right? At the end of the day, analytics is about working with lots and lots of data, and applying mathematical and statistical algorithms to data, right? So you have to be comfortable with quantitative skill sets, right? So you can't be somebody who's afraid of numbers. You know, that's definitely not going to work. Now, you don't have to be very, very skilled in math or stat in the sense that there are tools that will do a lot of the heavy lifting for you, but you cannot be somebody who says, you know, I just don't like working with numbers or I'm just very uncomfortable working with numbers, right? The second thing that I would emphasize quite strongly is, a logical sort of approach to problem solving, right? So you have to have, you should really be able to think in a structured manner and sort of say, okay, here's some framework that I will apply to get to the solution of the problem. So you have to be, somebody who has a structured way of thinking, a logical or an analytical way of thinking. And finally, thirst for knowledge, not domain knowledge necessarily, but at the end of the day, right, it is about problem solving for business, right? And, you know, these are complex problems. And so the solutions are not very simple, not very apparent, right? So you have to be able, you know, you have to have a high sense of curiosity, right? You have to be interested in getting to the solution and you will run through many iterations to get to the solution. But you have to be able to, you know, sort of persist and, you know, ask the right questions and sort of figure out till you get to the solution, right? So those are what I call inherent skills, right? But obviously there is a set of technical skills that you will need in order to learn analytics or big data analytics or machine learning, right? And these are typically what I focus on. Let me just go back. Sorry. You do need a reasonably good understanding of statistics, right? And how statistics is applied to business data, business context, right? So descriptive statistics and inferential statistics, because a lot of algorithms are based on statistics. And so you do need a good grounding in statistics to be able to build a successful career in, data science or data analytics. You have to have a knowledge of the methodology, the analytics methodology, which is how do you sort of approach an analytics problem? What are the different steps that you will have to execute in what order? You know, what is the sort of outputs expected at each stage? You need to have a good understanding and the ability to apply the analytics methodology. Then three, you obviously have to have knowledge of multiple algorithms, right? This could be predictive modeling algorithms, this could be machine learning algorithms, but you do need good understanding. And when I say good understanding, how they work, how you would apply them, you know, how do you sort of interpret the results that you get when you apply these algorithms. All of that you will need good understanding of. And then you will definitely need knowledge of specialized analytical tools. So Excel, for example, you can do a fair amount of data analysis and a little bit of analytics in Excel. But Excel was not built to be an analytics tool, right? You need tools like R or Python or SAS. These are tools that were built for, you know, applying statistical or machine learning algorithms to large volumes of data. So you do need knowledge of all of that, right? So someone's asking me for books. You know, if you're looking for books on statistics, then I would recommend looking at books that are more applied in nature. You know, one of the books that I do like is Statistics for Management, Levin and Rubin. That's a great book. If you can get like the 8th or 9th edition, I think they have a lot of good examples. So that may be a good place for you to start. How Minitab helps in this context? Minitab is another sort of analytics tool, right? Some of these tools like SPSS and Minitab are used more in the market research industry and sometimes where the volumes of data are not as high. They are menu-based systems, so you know, it's sort of, it's, sometimes when you have menu-based systems, it's easy for people with non-technical skills to use it. But you will sacrifice some amount of flexibility because it is menu-driven, right? And so, if you're thinking about doing, you know, a lot of companies when they're going to do serious data manipulation or analytics, they invest in tools like R or Python or SAS, right? So if we talk a little bit about, if you talk a little bit about machine learning, right? Machine learning increasingly has become more and more important. Like I said, in sort of a lot of, because of the sort of data that we are working with, semi-structured, unstructured data, and sort of a lot of the, you know, analytics that needs to happen real time, people are more open to applying machine learning algorithms that are a little bit more black box models because they are more, you know, they are okay to make the trade-off between accuracy and explainability, right? So they may not worry so much about what is happening in the model and why is it working the way it is. They are more interested in saying, okay, if you know, if I feed the algorithm a lot of data, the algorithm keeps learning and its accuracy keeps improving. And I'm not so worried about what is going on in the algorithm as much as I'm looking at the output. And machine learning especially is very strongly applied when you have very, very large data sets or big data sets. So the combination of machine learning and big data is definitely something that is becoming increasingly important, right? And that you can see that in, you know, if you look at machine learning trends and analytics trends, you know, if you look at jobs for machine learning and analytics, you can see that there is an increasing trend for machine learning jobs. And a lot of machine learning algorithms now, you know, if you go to KD Nuggets, for example, they will tell you, you know, when they do these surveys of analytics professionals, you know, what algorithms are people using, what algorithms are people learning. Machine learning algorithms like, you know, random forest or k-means or neural networks are increasingly becoming very, very popular, right? Almost must know, right? The other thing that I will like to emphasize here is that, you know, when people think about data science, they do think a lot about the technical skill sets, right? But, you know, at the end of the day, data science and analytics is always operating in the context of business, right? Because you are essentially solving problems for business units or business teams, right? And so as a data scientist, you know, statistical skills are very, very important and programming skills in order to use tools like R and Python are very important. But there is also a huge emphasis placed on domain knowledge and, you know, the ability to sort of really, you know, you know, people don't emphasize the soft skills enough. But the ability to sort of communicate the results, the ability to sort of, you know, make sure that the results are presented effectively using the right visualizations, all of that become increasingly important. And as data, sort of data science jobs increase, you know, the ability to, for example, make sure that you have project management skills within analytics also becomes important. So all of these are also things that you should focus on, not just the technical skills. Obviously, technical skills are very important, but these are also equally important, right? Let me see if there are some questions. I can see some book related questions and I think we'll come back. Someone asked me a SAS. In terms of technology, which is better, R, Python, SAS? Okay, so this is a question that I get a lot. Okay, and let me answer that by saying it's not really a question of which is better or which is worse, right? They all have, you know, advantages and disadvantages. Okay. And they're all used in different situations. So, for example, SAS, you know, SAS has been around for many years, you know, 40 years now. And you know, it was it has been the number one for a very, very long time. And there have been a lot of reasons for its success. One, among all the tools available at that time, SAS was the best when it came to processing large volumes of data, right? SAS was really by far the best. And then also in terms of SAS programming language, you know, that was easy to learn. So even people who didn't have programming backgrounds could easily learn the SAS programming language, right? So there is a lot of people and a lot of companies that have used SAS for many years. And so there is a lot of institutional code that is already in SAS. And, you know, the systems work very well. Also from a regulatory perspective, sometimes, you know, banking, for example, banking companies sometimes have to use from a regulatory perspective tools that are, are okay from a regulatory perspective to use, right? So SAS has been very popular, but, you know, SAS is not free, as someone is pointing out. SAS is not free. In fact, it is very, very expensive. And so over time, you know, there have been open source tools that have been developed. R was actually developed, you know, 15 years ago, more than 15 years ago, but it's only in the last 8 to 10 years that it has, you know, started to become really popular. Now, R is great when it comes to, for example, you know, if you want to do visualizations, R is a lot easier to, you know, visualizations in R are a lot easier to do than in SAS. You know, R is completely open source. So whatever it is that you want to do in R, there'll probably be a package for it now. Whereas with SAS, it is very specialized. You know, if you want to do, for example, a serious time series forecasting, you'll have to buy another module of SAS. You know, if you want to do, you know, SAS visualization or visual analytics, then you have to buy another module. Whereas with R, you know, everything is free. There are packages for everything. And so, you know, people increasingly are preferring to use R. But, you know, if you come from a non-programming background, then R is a little bit more difficult to learn than SAS, right? And similarly, Python, you know, Python is becoming more and more popular. You know, over time, people are adding a lot more packages, you know, on functionality to it. Between R and Python, R is still more preferred for data science and, you know, to some extent, machine learning. But over time, Python is also going to become very, very popular. But at the end of the day, right, it is not, if you think about it, these are just tools. Right? These are just tools in the sense that R and Python are not analytics because they are simply tools. You put in a command and they do something. The analytics piece is the ability to tell R or Python or SAS what to do, right? And whether you use R or you use SAS or you use Python, if you're building, for example, a logistic regression model or you're building a decision tree or you're trying to implement a neural networks, you know, if you give it the same set of commands, you will get the same set of output. Right? So don't get too hung up on the tools. And the fact is, you know, now we are talking about R and Python. 5 years from now, there will be other tools. Right? It is the ability to use the tool in order to perform the analysis that you require is what is important. And, you know, don't, you know, that is very, very important to understand. Right? Okay, so then I'd like to spend the last couple of minutes, you know, before I open it up for Q&A, on the program that, you know, that we've designed in partnership with the Graham School, which is the integrated program in data science and machine learning. Because again, a lot of people are interested in building these skills, but you need a, you know, data science is a very, very technically complex field, right? There is a reason that people get premium salaries in data science because you are doing a lot of technically complex work that has a lot of strategic value. So in order to do data science well, you need multiple skills. You know, you need, like I said, you know, statistical skills, you need tool skills, you need domain understanding, you need analytics methodology understanding, you need different sets of algorithms. So really, you know, this program that, you know, that we've designed with the Graham School is an integrated program in data science and machine learning. So the focus is on data science, but machine learning, big data play a big part in this, right? And the aim of this program is to sort of give people a really good, solid, foundational understanding of data science and sort of equip them with the most relevant and most sought after skills currently in data science and analytics, right? It is a blended program. So there will be some in-person classes and there will be some online classes. As well as self-paced learning. It's basically fairly intensive because we are, you know, the way the program is designed, we are going to start from assuming that people have no prior knowledge of data science. And in 9 months, we will cover a lot of different concepts within data science and machine learning and big data. And there is the choice of using some domain electives. So, you know, depending on your area of interest, marketing or finance or supply chain, etc. So the idea is to give people a really, really solid understanding of data science, machine learning, big data, and sort of really make people ready for applying these right away in their roles or in future roles, right? So if you look at what we cover in the program, you know, it starts with exploratory data analysis, data mining, R for data science, data analysis for decision making, and then of course a lot of big data analytics, advanced predictive models, advanced machine learning models. And then, like I said, some emphasis on soft skills as well, which is, again, very, very important. A lot of analytics projects sometimes fail because people are not able to justify the solution or explain the solution or defend the solution or really come up with a good story about what the model really say. So there is an emphasis in this program about, you know, making sure that there is storytelling with data skills, that there is project management skills, so that, you know, you really are a well-rounded sort of, you have a well-rounded outcome at the end of this program, right? So this is broadly about what you get in the program, and this information is available on the website as well. But this is broadly what you get. It's a blended program, so it's a combination of self-paced in-person training as well as online training. And there is a capstone project where the emphasis is on working with real-life data from companies that give us projects, and sort of making sure that you're able to apply everything that you've learned on the live projects. So that's a little bit about the program itself. And again, I'm happy to answer any questions about the program if people have it. But in the meantime, let me go back and answer, specific questions. I saw some career-related questions, which I'm happy to answer. Or if there are other specific questions that you would like me to answer, I'm happy to do that. Okay, let me just scroll up and see if there are questions that I have missed from before. Okay, let me see. So GP Sharma says, I have extensive experience in business intelligence along with ETL. I'm working on shifting my career in analytics. However, I'm facing a challenge. Okay, so this I answered about the book. So I think that's good. And I think there have been other suggestions as well. Okay.
Sarita, there are questions in the Q&A tab as well.
Okay, let me just go to the Q&A tab. Oh, okay, I can see lots of questions. Okay, I'm just going to go through this in order. So Chirag is saying, started learning R, so help me what I should do for more, any small projects based on R as I've just started learning R. So great that you've started learning R. Again, I do want to make a distinction between learning R and learning data science, right? R is a tool. You have to apply it for data science. So one way to do that is to sort of, make sure you're learning some data science as well. And, the algorithms and, how they're built and how they're applied. And maybe one way of practicing would be to try and, use competition sites like Kaggle, for example. You may be able to get a good start there. Sudhakar says, 9+ years in telecom domain, shall I come into this field? How much difficult? So again, see, I think, when people think about analytics, it's not one role within analytics, right? There are multiple roles within analytics and data science. So traditional roles have been analytics services, right? So where you are, your role is to be a data scientist, and you sort of build models, and you sort of deliver analytics solutions for internal or external clients, right? But there are other roles within analytics, and sometimes if you think about it, you could be a domain expert with analytics as your differentiator, right? So if you are, for example, thinking about somebody like Sudhakar who's saying, I'm in telecom for 9 years. What you should really look at in terms of analytics is to be able to expand your role within telecom with analytics, right? So you should ideally be looking at telecom analytics roles. And, a lot of telecom companies deal with lots and lots of data, and they have fairly large analytics teams, right? So you want to try and find a role where your telecom knowledge can be leveraged, so you can use it, but you're also performing analytics, so your role has changed, right? Okay. Saurabh says, working as a senior analyst in business analytics for a giant pharma company, but I use only Excel and PPT to solve business problems. So there are, like pharma companies, there are analytics teams for pharma companies. So for example, we've done a lot of training for pharma companies that do use fairly advanced analytics. So I think it really depends on trying to sort of extend, I think the fact that you're already doing analytics using Excel is a good thing. Now, you should try and aim for roles where you know, there is a little bit more advanced analytics that can be used. Okay, so let me see. Does machine learning or predictive analytics does not come under data analytics but data science? No. So again, a lot of these terms are used interchangeably. So they're all data science. Okay, I'm just trying to make sure that I'm answering questions that I have not already answered. Okay, does neural networks make it place in analytics? Yes, it's a machine learning algorithm. How is Spark placed when compared to other tools like R and Python, which are ruling the industry currently? So Spark is, you know, is more on the big data side. It's a way for people to implement machine learning algorithms on big data. You know, people use Python, you know, they use a PySpark library within Spark sometimes. So Python is also sometimes used as a part of Spark. So it's, again, it's not one versus the other. I think it depends on, you know, the problem that you're trying to solve and the sort of systems that you're working with. Spark is, you know, more people on the big data side tend to use Spark. Alaa is saying, is there a case where I need to use both ML and descriptive analytics? Yes. Again, you know, these problems are fairly large. So it's not that you will use a single algorithm to come up with the full solution. You know, there will be places where you may end up using descriptive analytics. They may be in the same project. You might end up using descriptive analytics and predictive models and, you know, as well as machine learning algorithms. Right, so you will need to have knowledge of all of these things. Is it important to have knowledge of various tools or just an understanding of process is okay? You do have to have knowledge of tools, and the rate at which the industry is changing, you will need to have knowledge of multiple tools. Where does experiment designing come? Experiment designing comes in inferential statistics. So typically when you're talking about hypothesis testing, then you also talk about experimental design. You know, how do you set it up? How do you set up your test so that you can perform a valid hypothesis test? Manju says, working as a lecturer, would like to move to big data analytics. I'm from economic statistics and econometrics. So I think your background is great because you're already from a stats and econometrics background. So it should be easy for data analytics. I think where you will have to focus on is being able to pick up programming skills, because that is definitely something that you're going to use quite extensively. What is the best part in learning machine learning? So there are a lot of resources, but again, I think, you know, people tend to underestimate how complex this field is. And for you to really learn it well, I think a strong foundation is important, right? You really have to be able to understand when and how and, you know, these algorithms are used. And you have to make sure that you get enough practice with business data sets and hands-on experience. So, you know, it's one thing to learn about the algorithm, but it's another thing to actually implement it in practice and sort of learn by implementing. And that becomes very, very important, right? And that's why we also emphasize a lot of case study sort of approach to learning, because unless you get your hands dirty with real data, with, you know, that's very noisy, that has a lot of issues, you know, where the solutions are not very straightforward, you're really not going to learn too much. Is machine learning about programming? Is it for computer science graduates? So there is an element of programming in machine learning, because you will possibly use programming to sort of, you know, for the tools that you will use to implement machine learning. But machine learning is not only about programming. You know, at least in the context of data mining and analytics, it's about using algorithms to be able to come up with solutions for business requirements. So let me see. Vijay says, what are skills in big data, Hadoop, are required with, along with machine learning? So again, big data is not one technology or one tool, right? Hadoop is simply one part of it. But at the end of the day, if your data is being managed or processed on a big data system, then you need to have an understanding of how that system works in its entirety and how do you connect an analytics engine to a big data system, right? SaaS is paid software. How do you get hands-on and learn it? So I think SaaS provides an academic version for students. But otherwise, it is, you know, it is a paid software. So it is sort of hard. In interviews, what all are required or what interviews look for in terms of hiring a data scientist and analyst, right? So people are looking for, I think, you know, from a hiring perspective, someone who is not just good in one tool or one technique or, you know, one thing, right? They want to be able for you to demonstrate that you understand, you know, how analytics is applied. So very often in analytics interviews, people will ask you to walk through a project or, you know, give them some example of an analytics project that you worked on. And what they try to do is sort of understand whether you have really understood what the business problem was. How did you translate that into an analytics problem statement? What was the sort of data exploration or data preparation that you had to do? You know, how did the model building process happen? How did you decide on, you know, what your final model was? How did you validate the model? How did you convert the model to insight? So they're really looking for the experience of having built and applied these models, right? It's not theory, right? How do you see data science and analytics to develop in the future? What about AI and data specialist careers in the future? They will be, and you know, increasingly, I'm very confident that there will be more and more roles because that's where the world is moving to. You know, we are definitely generating more data. We'll continue to generate more data. So we will need specialized skills in data sort of handling, data manipulation, data modeling, data insights. All of these will be required. Can IDM be totally online? No, it's a blended program. So essentially, the way we've designed it is that it is for working professionals. So you will have 6 contact sessions in Bangalore, but the contact sessions are on weekends, so Saturday, Sunday. So you don't really have to miss work in that sense. Difference between data analyst and data scientist role in a company. Sometimes they are used similarly, but data analysts are people who the emphasis sometimes is more on, you know, data analyst or business analyst is more on domain knowledge and sort of working with the data. With data, you know, data scientist, it is also the programming and, you know, so it's basically data scientist is a little bit more of a senior term, right? Somebody who's really good at stats and business knowledge and programming is probably a data scientist, and that's why they're called unicorns, because it is rare to have that combination. Data analysts are people who work with business teams and work with data and typically primarily do reporting or business intelligence or historical data analysis kind of work. For non-technical people, is it worthwhile to learn for a year then utilize in the industry directly? Yes, definitely. Okay, let me just make sure that I'm answering questions. Sujit Gupta is asking what algorithms do we start with respect to practicing work with machine learning. Start with the simple ones, which is linear regression, logistic regression, maybe k-means, and then you can go on to the more complicated ones. What to expect when your company says interview will be based on analytics? I spoke about that, right? Typically, they want to see evidence of you having worked on an analytics project and sort of how you went through the project and what were your learnings from that. For a non-computer science undergrad, where do I start in data science field? You will need to learn, you know, you will need to... See, data science is a multidisciplinary field. So it's not that you start with R or you start with statistics. You have to start with data science, which will include, you know, some understanding of statistics, some understanding of R, some understanding of methodology, and so on. FQ says, please share details of the program link website. Be happy to do that. Let me send that to you in a bit. Vijay says, I'm a master's from Tier 1 University in India. I'm already familiar with Python. I want to make a career in machine learning. Since you're a computer science master's, that's great. Since you are comfortable with Python, I think what you need to do is sort of really learn a fair amount of machine learning algorithms and implementing machine learning algorithms in Python. I would also recommend learning some R, you know, because there are more R roles than Python roles. But what you really need to do is focus on, you know, making sure you have a good understanding of multiple machine learning algorithms, that you have some understanding of big data systems, because typically data will reside on big data systems, and you have an understanding of the interpretation of output from these machine learning models. Deepak says, I've experience in big data like Spark, Scala, big data, what to do to move into machine learning and data science. Yeah, I would recommend doing a certification course like the program that I'm describing now, I think would be a great start, or, you know, even shorter certification. But so you have big data knowledge, I would emphasize focusing on machine learning. Okay, let me just scroll down a little bit. So Zach says, Andrew's machine learning course on Coursera is a great place to start. Yes, it is. Do I need to have a master's in analytics to kickstart a career as a data scientist? Not necessarily. There are not that many master's programs as well. But certainly people do expect, because there is a lot of interest in this, many people are starting to get trained in machine learning, in data science. People do expect a very, very solid set of skills. This is not something that you can get away with the superficial knowledge. You will have to have a very deep sort of understanding. Okay. Right? Okay, let me just make sure that I am answering questions in order. How to practice on Kaggle? Aman Shah is saying how to practice on Kaggle. It's fairly straightforward. You sign up for an account on Kaggle, and there are data sets, and you can sort of really practice there. People have also included codes there, so if you want to try with somebody else's code, you can also do that. What are the fees and how long does it take? This particular program, the fees are $5,000, and it's a 9-month course, so that's how long it takes. I'm using R to analyze web data, mostly visualization of aggregated data. How could IDM help me, as I've also completed data science with R? So IDM is meant for people who want to build long-term careers in analytics, and they're interested in making sure that they have a really good set of skills that are required in the data science industry. So you have data science with R, but there's also big data, there's also machine learning, there's also, the storytelling, etc. So the IDM course is meant for people who want to make sure that they have a really significant set of skills and that are very, very job oriented. So that's how I think you would look at IDM. I think the fact that you know R is an advantage, you will be able to pick up all the other skills a lot easier. Garvit says, I've studied C language, could not ace the subject. How different is coding in analytics from C? It is different. These programming languages are not as complex. But at the end of the day, any programming language is about learning a syntax and sort of getting familiar with it, right? It's not very, very difficult. We get a lot of students who don't have any programming experience, and they are able to pick up skills in R and SAS and Python. Can I solve any business problem using existing ML algorithms, or I want to create a new one? So most business problems, there is probably an algorithm that can solve, but the algorithm needs to be tweaked based on the particular problem and its parameters. Of course, there are people who create new algorithms, but it's relatively rare. 80-90% of the problems typically are solved by very popular, the most popularly used algorithms. Do we have AI related packages in SAS? Yes. Any models built in the fashion industry? So I did read reasonably recently about somebody who was trying to predict trends for the fashion industry using image data. So it does exist, right? Garrick says, I have experience in data analysis, worked in startups, worked in R, Python, Tableau. Only problem is that I have experience in form of internships, basically cannot find a good data analyst job. See, as long as you have some experience, I think, you should not find it that difficult to find a job. As long as you can defend what, you have to be able to explain what you did, how you did it, etc. But otherwise, the fact that you have R, Python, Tableau, Excel, all are good things. Maybe you also want to invest a little time in learning a little bit of data science on top of this, because these are tools. But I don't see why you should have too much trouble finding a job. Pallavi says, part of market research firm, which in turns out syndicated market research, where do you think analytics can be used? So a lot of market research is qualitative data analysis, right? And so an extension of that is to start using quantitative data and running quantitative data analysis. So, I think that's where it would fit in. You sort of, improve, let's say, the research output by including some quantitative analysis as well. How are various tools like SAS are distributed according to different sectors? Yeah, so there are some sectors where some tools are popular, though it keeps changing. For example, financial services and healthcare, for example, extensively use SAS because they were early adopters and they've been using SAS, and they all work with very large data sets. E-commerce companies, startups, for example, tend to use a lot more R. And increasingly, more and more companies are moving towards R and open source tools. Surjit says, all job posting require analytics experience in analytics from being a software development background from retail. So there are ways of showing that you have some understanding of analytics and application of analytics, right? You should make sure that your foundation knowledge of analytics is very, very solid, right? Because like I said, it is a difficult field. It is a complex field, and you need to make sure that you have a good understanding. So make sure that you're investing in learning about it properly. The second is, a lot of these sites like Kaggle, for example, you can demonstrate how good your skills are, right? It is free. You sign up, and then let's say that you participate in a couple of contests. You have a reasonable, you get better over time. You can look at all the codes that you've used. You can display them on Kaggle. You can display them on GitHub, etc. And that would be a great way to to sort of show prospective employers what you're capable of doing in analytics. Khushbu is saying job prospects for data analysis in Kolkata compared to Bangalore and Delhi. There are, you know, Calcutta is actually fairly, you know, it's a fairly, you know, it's a place where there is a fair amount of analytics hiring that happens. A lot of companies have, you know, branches in Calcutta. So, you know, Wipro or Cognizant and all them do analytics out of that location. HSBC, for example. So it's not a, you know, it's definitely some where some analytics hiring definitely happens. Not at the scale of Bangalore or New Delhi, but it's also quite quite good. 2 years of work experience is valuable, or 2 years of master's degree? Depends on what your long-term career option is. You know, a master's degree is always a good idea. It could be after 2 years of work experience, right? Is there something called a machine learning engineer? Not that I know of. There are data engineers, but usually the machine learning specialist is what I am more aware of. Okay, Ashish, I'm not sure what your question was. Is there any difference between deep learning and machine learning? Again, I think people get very excited about deep learning. It is an extension of machine learning. It is more complex machine learning. But over time, a lot of people are going to do more and more deep learning as the you know, as the solutions become more and more complex. So we will end up doing more deep learning. How much does it cost to get into this course? It's $5,000. How ML with Python? Yeah, Python has machine learning libraries. I have 6 years of experience with ETL data warehousing. Is it a good move into analytics? I think so, because you know, you're already dealing with data, and a logical extension of what you do is to sort of you know, do more analysis and analytics, right? So I think it is a it's a good move. 5 years experience, 6 years in project management. I've learned data science and implemented ML algorithms through SAS. Why would a typical interviewer look in me? Will it be more data visualization and presentation, or more of technical skills? They will look definitely for more you know, data visualization and presentation skills, but at the same time, they'll want to make sure that your technical skills are solid. But given that you have 12 years of experience overall, they will look at you for senior profiles. So a lot of it will be communication, project management, sort of understand resource planning, etc. But at the same time, they will expect you to have good technical skills. What would be your suggestion for a programmer willing to switch to analytics? Depends on how many years of experience you have and what your background is. If you're looking at it from the IT side, I would recommend start with big data and try and get into big data analytics. If you're coming from the business side, then look at something that is a little bit more data science or machine learning focused. Vineet says, I'm looking for a career in machine learning. I've started learning about building regression models, neural networks in both R and Python, working on data available in Kaggle. What platforms are there for us to showcase our work? So Kaggle leaderboards obviously is something that you should look at. If you do well in Kaggle competitions, then the leaderboard ranking is something that you should put on your resume, and people pay a lot of attention to it. Another is to use a platform like GitHub to showcase the codes that you have generated, or you know, any outputs that you've created. That would be a great way to showcase it. How much should I focus on big data? Again, you know, more and more data is going to start residing on big data systems. So you don't necessarily have to be, you know, very, very expert with big data, but you will eventually need to know, for example, how to connect to a big data system. So if you're working with R, how do you connect R to a big data system to extract data, for example, something that you will probably have to learn. So you can't ignore it, you know, completely. Okay, I think I've mostly answered questions. Dipankar says, completed my master's in statistics, done research and developing yield prediction models, and I have goods on with R and SPSS. What should I do to get a good job? I think you already have enough experience to be able to get a job, because you are talking about building models and working on R. I think that's pretty good. You know, while you're looking for a job, just try and improve your algorithm knowledge, because that would just be useful to have more algorithm knowledge. I have an MSc in stats. Do I need certifications in ML, AI, data science to get ahead? I have more than 3 years of industry experience in analytics and predictive modeling. Not necessarily. You already have industry experience, but it helps to have advanced machine learning algorithms as a way to sort of move faster in your career, right? So a lot of since you already have analytics experience, it would be a great idea for you to try and leverage, you know, more knowledge in machine learning and sort of look at more complex data analysis. FQ says, I live in Dubai and work in finance banking sector. How can I get formal analytics education like IDM? I am not aware of any programs in Dubai, unfortunately. So I'm not very sure if I can give you solutions for Dubai. What's the difference between a data scientist and a decision scientist? Typically, it's the same thing. Typically, it is the same thing. Naresh says, do companies expect good at data structures, algorithms, and problem-solving skills for analytics? Yes. Can analysis of data also be automated? That's a great question, and a lot of it is. A lot of analysis of data does get automated, and someone sent me an article at the beginning of this webinar about saying, is it the end of data science? So certainly a lot of analysis can be automated, but at the end of the day, you know, insights and, you know, sort of finding really actionable insights is something that still needs human intervention. So very simple analysis, basic analysis, visualizations possibly can be automated, but what do you do with it? How do you interpret it? What recommendations would you make? That would still need human intervention. Master's degree in computer science, certification in data science, currently working as a full stack developer, as a fresher, are there opportunities? Yes, there are plenty of opportunities. Let me just make sure. Do you feel like continuous learning is always necessary? Yes. It is true. And I empathize what you feel, but it is true. We, you know, the rate of change is only increasing in terms of, you know, the innovation that is happening and, you know, the applications that are being developed and the sort of thinking that happens in data science. It's only, the rate of change is only increasing. So continuous learning is just, it is very much a necessity. You know, the days of, you know, having, you know, a set of skills and making them work for you for 10, 15 years are gone, unfortunately. Is Chennai for job prospects? Which city is good for data science jobs in India? You know, there are data science jobs available most in Bangalore, New Delhi, but also Chennai, Hyderabad, Kolkata, Bombay, and then a lot of tier two, Pune, a lot of tier two cities, Coimbatore, Kochi, for example, analytics jobs are available. Learning R from online videos of Mike Marin. I'm sorry, I'm not aware of it, so I can't really comment on that. Any discount provided in IDM? We have a few scholarships available, you know, based on, you know, eligibility. You may be eligible for a scholarship on the IDM program. So I think I have answered most questions.
Sure. I think, Sarita, thanks a lot for taking that time out for, you know, answering the questions and then keeping the audience engaged throughout the webinar. So is there any way people can find or reach out for more information for the program specifically or any other related questions?
Definitely. Let me, type my message. If you want to find out about the program specifically, if you just write to info@jigsawacademy.com or let me just put in the last slide, which had information specific about the program. So if you just give me a minute, let me just minimize this and just go to the last slide. I think that had information on how we get to it. So let me just make sure that I have it. Okay. Okay, for some reason, okay, here. If you go to our site, you will be able to see information on the program itself. Otherwise, if you can just write to this, the email address that I just shared on the chat, we'll be able to provide information.
Yeah, thanks, Sarita, and great session there for people, and really appreciate the time you took out for answering those questions. And then I'm sure that the webinar was helpful for a lot of aspirants. And then hope to see you in future in more such sessions.
Thank you, everyone. Lots of interest, great questions. Thank you again. And again, if you have other questions you'd like us to answer, please write to us, and we'd be happy to answer.
Thanks, Arita.
Okay, thanks, Kunal. Thank you. Good night, everyone.